Get ready to enter the Thrive Time Show.
We started from the bottom, now we're here. We started from the bottom, and we'll show you how to get here. We started from the bottom, now we're here. We started from the bottom, now we're here.
We started from the bottom, now we're on the top, teaching you the systems to get what we got. Colin Dixon's on the hooks, I break down the books. Z's bringing some wisdom and the good looks. As the father of five, that's why I'm alive. So if you see my wife and kids, please tell them hi. It's the C&Z up on your radio. And now 3, 2, 1, here we go.
We started from the bottom, now we're here.
You're talking about something right here that is so countercultural that it could almost be viewed as offensive by some, because if you think about it, you know, you have the cover of Forbes, which is a great organization, and then you have Fortune and Fast Company and all that, and we very rarely celebrate a great dad.
Mm.
Yeah. You know, we always celebrate the business award, but we very rarely say, here is a man who's a father of three and all three are doing well. And you've been on the record of saying that what you're seeing with your kids in their development is more rewarding than anything you experienced. Yeah. Do you really believe that? It's more rewarding to be
able to... I mean, I've had times when I've gone to church, I sometimes preach, and I've had times when I preached at church and on the way home, argue with my wife on the way home about everything, about stuff I said when I was preaching and all kinds of things. So, you know, there's an emptiness to that. You know, so I think there's not enough talk about, I don't even think it has anything to do with religion. It has to do with the family really is a structure that our society is built on. It really is. And if we have strong families, we have strong society, period. I don't care what your faith is. I'm telling you, if we have strong families, we have a strong society. And so so to me, you know, this is where we have to find that good balance, I think, and understand you're not successful in business. You're not successful in life if you can't take care of those things that are right in front of you.
So to me specifically, this is a story I used to say. Well, my dad worked night shift, Dave. So he was never really home with me during the day.
Right.
So I don't know what it's like to really have a dad that's involved.
Right.
What do you say to, I mean, again, because we're setting these expectations. If I'm saying, well, the reason why I do this is because this was how I was raised, this is my background, are you telling me just take it up a notch? Find somebody that can...
Find somebody that can help you walk through that, because, you know, that's the... We need to see the examples. We need to be the examples. Mm. Then we need to... see the example. I always look for people who are at that next level for me. So if I go to a business or a church or whatever, I'll go find the people who are leaders who I look up to, and I'll sit down in front of them and I'll say, well, you know, how are you doing this? Like, I don't even know how to manage my day. How do you get through this? Yeah. You know, how do you run an organization like this and still have time, excuse me, for your wife? I need to know this stuff. I'm not very good at it. I'm trying to figure it all out. So at every level we are, I try to be a mentor. We have a Bible study on Wednesdays, and I try to be a mentor to the guys at my table, whatever ways I can encourage them and help them and walk through things. Yeah. I have kids who are almost all off to college now. So guys who have younger kids, I can say, okay, I was there. I know exactly what you're going through right now. Try to be patient with him, love on him, and give him whatever advice and help him walk through that trial.
Now, when you played in the NBA in 1998, I mean, you essentially were making almost $15 million a year at that point, which is it's like $180,000 a game. And the reason why I bring that up is because, did you ever feel like that the expectations that others were setting for you were too high? Because on the media, you know, we're talking, all these guys like me, you know, we're sitting around grilling food. We're talking about, well, David, he's got to bring more intensity. He's got to show more passion.
Yeah.
David has got to play harder. He's not running back on defense the way he should. You know, did you ever feel like the expectations were too high?
I felt like there was a lot of pressure. Now, expectations for other people's expectations, I'd never worried about too much.
Okay.
People will put ridiculous expectations on you. I mean, I sat and I remember them talking about Michael Jordan, saying Michael needed to do this and Michael needed... That guy is the best player on the planet. And yet he still wasn't making people happy. I have no idea how that's possible. So, you know, there's always someone there waiting to criticize you. You know, that's there. I think what we need to set is the expectations for ourselves and understanding that, you know, we've been gifted with certain things. And given my circumstances, my gifts, I better answer the bell, right? And that's kind of a biblical thing for me. It's you've been given certain talents and you can't bury them in the ground. You've got to come back and say, hey, you've given me 5 talents. I've invested them. Now here's 10. Thank you, Lord. So I think that's where we draw our own expectations. You have talent. I don't care what it is. You have abilities and you've been gifted with certain things. You need to invest those things in people and in society and then come back and say, I've used them in a positive way.
Who's helping you set higher expectations for yourself, or who has helped you set higher expectations for
my
yourself?
My wife, number one. So that's why it says that a wife is a good thing. Having a wife is a good thing because she'll help me stretch. She helps me learn. She helps me grow. And you know, even though sometimes it can be challenging for you to accept what she says or how she says it, you have to understand that she's a gift to you. And so that's the first level of challenge right there. And then I look at my kids, that's the second level of challenge there. So, you know, my sons will do the same things I used to do. And then I think, are you kidding me? I keep telling you not to do that. But it's wonderful because you grow, you stretch, you learn. My expectations go up as I see what we're capable of doing. And I think it's a great challenge.
So you don't view your wife, the feedback that she gives you, mm-hmm. as criticism to be ignored or to argue with or to defend your position. You view it as she's a sincere gift. She's a precious gift from God, and she's here to be sort of your life coach or to give you these sorts of mirror.
Absolutely. No, she's a big part of that. And I think my wife helps drive my expectations higher. My children help drive my expectations higher. I have to be an example for my kids. So that means day by day, I have to be above reproach. I have to come in there every day and set a tone. And my kids are watching me. They're saying, Dad, you're slipping. Dad, you said something mean to Mom. Or Dad, you did this. So my actions, they push me to a higher level. They set the expectations. And you might think, oh, that's ridiculous. You can't be perfect. Of course we can't be perfect. But we can strive. We can push ourselves to that level where every day I'm trying to be a better person. I'm trying to be a better man. And I think that we have natural things around us that push us up to that level if we accept it.
Now, principle number 4 is offering a high degree of service. George Washington Carver was so into this concept of offering a high degree of service to the point that he explains that essentially at the end of the day, at the end of your life, that's how you're measured. Could you maybe clarify what George Washington Carver was talking about when he was talking about offering a high degree of service and what that means to you?
Yeah, no. Carver was, you know, like I said, one of my heroes. And one of his quotes that I love to talk to the kids about was, I would say that he said, it doesn't matter how tall you are, how wealthy a man is, it is simply his service that will measure his success. And so, you know, having these kids understand what you give back from the talents that you've been given is everything. That's what success is. It is not going to be what your paycheck looks like. It's not going to be how powerful looking you are or what car you drive. None of that stuff is going to matter. It is going to be simply how you use the talents you've been given and what you pay into other people's lives that's going to measure your success in life.
And if you're a small business owner, you know, there's a lot of talk, if you watch, it doesn't matter which president it is, if it's President Obama or it was President Bush, they're all going to say, well, you know, American business is the backbone of our country and we need small business owners to focus on growth and everything. Really, it comes down to, usually in American businesses, there's a dude or a lady and 10 employees and that's what it comes down to. Why, if you're speaking to that person specifically that owns the business, they have 10 or 15 employees, why is it so important for them to offer a high degree of service to their team and to their customers?
Because it adds value to our society. I mean, it really is that simple. And you know, I think that when you add value, you become more valuable and your business will become more valuable. That's a very underrated thing. A lot of us think about, we grow up thinking about how much we can take. You know, as children, we're always taking. We're always, what can you give me? Who's feeding me? What's next? And then as you grow to be an adult, you learn that it's not always about you. You know, it's about what you can do. As a mom, you certainly learn it's about me pouring myself out so that these kids can grow. And that's where my value lies. Mm. And in a business that hopefully as you mature, you understand that's what your business should be about. That's how you grow. That's how you lead. You do something significant is you learn how can my business be a service to society? How can I meet a need that's not there? How can I build up our society? That will grow you. You know, when you're just taking all the time, your business is going to have a short shelf life.
Well, here's what I've tried to do with my wife. You know, I try to get home and I try to say, baby, I'll be home at 6. I don't know if you've used this move at all. This is the move I do. So I'll be home around 6. And I try to get home like at 5:55 or 5:42 or 5:15, you know, because it's like she didn't expect that extra level, you know. Or with customers, sometimes when they show up, you know, I like to have a gift bag for them for their birthday or Easter. You know, so I'm always trying to exceed their expectation. What are some things that you do on a practical level on a daily basis to try to offer a high degree of service to the people in your life?
Well, I think I try to have a number one. My number one thing is treat people with respect. Mm. I don't care who it is. I mean, I always like to take a special, extra special time to acknowledge people who are serving. Mm. You know, people, whether it's the attendant in the bathroom or whether it's the gas station guy or whether it's, you know, whoever it is, the bellman at the hotel, take a minute to say hi, shake their hand, talk to them. You know, that's what I always try to do because those people are important. And their value is significant. I think that adds, to me, that adds value day by day. And it just, it builds up our society and it takes some of the, kind of the chains off of people, I think, you know, to know that they are valuable. And, you know, happy people, I don't care how much money you make.
Yeah.
But happy people add to our society.
I think one thing, it's if you're watching this, you know, you obviously were able to make millions of dollars playing in the game you love at a professional level. I started in an apartment, didn't have air conditioning. But it doesn't matter if you don't have money. I didn't have money. I did not have money. I didn't have money I could give you. I didn't have gifts I could give you. What right. I could do is with every bride and groom that I met, I used to meet every couple at Panera Bread. And I would meet him at Panera Bread, and I could just offer to buy him coffee, which is like $3. But taking the extra time to talk to the person and really get to know them and let them know you care beyond you as a customer. Right. I really care about you as a human.
Right.
That's something we can all do.
Right.
And that's the key to kind of climbing up the ladder there.
It is.
Now, when you were in the NBA, you won some, or not, I say won, you were received some humanitarian awards or some charitable, I guess, recognition. Yeah. For some of the work you did off the court. What were some of those awards and what were some of the things that you were passionate about doing off the court when the limelight was on you, when you were traveling 100 and something days a year?
I think it's a requirement that I give the awards back when I brag about them. So
okay.
I don't know. I mean, they're just different things. I mean, I think that it's really nice. I think sometimes it's important to be an example and, you know, allow people to recognize you for some of the things you're doing because it encourages other people to get involved and to have that as a part of their lives, right? Giving back is a part of your life. It's who you are, right? It's you grow up, you learn that, hey, if I've been blessed, and that means somebody blessed me, so I've got to be able to bless them.
In full disclosure, I'm forcing David to talk about this. He does not want to talk about his own awards, but I just want to bring this up. It's huge. Is you spent time off the court in the community.
Well, that was, I think that's a key. I mean, when I grew up going to public school. My dad was enlisted in the Navy. He was a senior chief, 20 years in the Navy. So we didn't grow up as overly privileged kids. We were middle-class kids and we worked hard. Mm-hmm. I knew I was going to have to work hard for a living and maybe I wouldn't make a boatload of cash, but I was going to be happy in my own shoes. Whatever I was doing, I was going to figure it out and be a good husband and father and all that sort of things. That's what my father taught me. So I hold it as a very high value to encourage people. Because this is America. It's a land of opportunity. It's a place where you can achieve anything you want to achieve. It is very possible. All you need sometimes is just encouragement.
Well, let's just say this. Let's just say, because I worked at Target, and I remember at Target, that's where I got my big break, by the way, it was at Target,
there you
where
go.
A guy came through the line, and long story short, I just tried to really offer that high degree of service, and it led to an internship that led to a connection that led to a... But if I'm watching this, let's say I'm working at a burger place right now, somebody who's making the minimum wage and I'm trying to work my way up to the top, what can I do in terms of offering a high degree of service? If I'm like, let's say I'm a janitor at the Spurs games, what can I do to move up from the janitorial level to maybe management level at...
Well, the very first thing you can do is try to distinguish yourself. And I'd say the one of the great ways to do that is to offer that extra degree of service. Very few people are willing to go out of their way to help people. And when you do that, managers will notice that. And so you will advance because of your heart and your work and all of the things put together. But certainly be a person that people want to be around. I mean, I know in your life, you don't like to be around people who suck life out of you. Mm. And nobody wants someone like that working for them. So, you know, I would say the best way to catch people's attention is to offer that extra degree of service, because there's so few people that are willing to do it.
And it's sort of a weird shift that has to happen, because by ultimately focusing on helping others, it helps you the most. Absolutely. So if you're working at this job and you want to get promoted, the number one key to that is just focusing on exceeding the expectations of everyone and really offering the high degree of service like George Washington Carver spoke of. And ultimately that's going to kind of boomerang back to you.
Absolutely. It is a defining characteristic, and it is one that will distinguish you from other people very quickly, because, you know, we all have those experiences where you call up somebody, they rude on the phone, or they do a crummy job when you ask them to come and fix something at your house. And, mm-hmm. you know, those are experiences you remember because they're frustrating and they're too common. But every once in a while, you run into that person who was extremely kind and helpful when you were tired and frustrated, and they changed your whole outlook. They changed your those people stand out far more, than the more common disappointment.
David, I appreciate you talking about these principles, and I really appreciate you allowing me to mention some of the work you've done off the court, even though you don't like to talk about those sorts of things, because it's just something you do. But again, I appreciate you being an example that we can look to and say, this guy might not be perfect, but he's at least aiming at the right ideals and is trying to. I appreciate you so much.
Thanks, Clay. Appreciate that.
Super Dave Robinson, how are you, sir?
Hey, how are you, Clay? Good to see you.
Doing excellent. We are talking about leadership, and specifically how the best leaders tend to be the best learners. Mm. Now, I really am excited to talk to you about this, because after you retired from the NBA, you actually went back to college. Why did you do that?
Because I felt like I needed to prepare myself for the business world. I feel like there's, when you're starting all over, there needs to be a common thread somewhere in there. And if you're going to be a leader of an organization, mm-hmm. A leader of a group of men, it is always nice to have a good solid base of wisdom and understanding. So yeah, I think it was important for me to go back to school and begin to get on the right foot.
What did you study? What did you go back to school and study?
Administration. I wanted to know how businesses work and what it was like to run a business. So I studied the organizational development.
You know, a lot of people who are watching this, there's a lot of business owners watching this, people who want to start businesses. Mm-hmm. And one thing that I know I was guilty of saying early on in my career is, I'm like, I'm too busy marketing to learn anything.
Right.
I'm too busy putting out fires to learn anything new. Yeah. I mean, I'm trying to just grow this business. I don't have time to learn. But if you were talking directly to, let's say, the 19-year-old version of myself, where I'm saying, I'm too busy working to learn, what would you say about the importance of learning?
I would say there's things like Thrive Now that you can study in your own free time, and practical things that will move you forward. Going back to school and getting a master's degree is not an option for everyone.
Yeah.
That was something I actually had the opportunity to do, so I chose to do it. I felt like it would give me credibility as well as wisdom and knowledge. But sometimes we've got our feet on the ground. Sometimes we're working, and we're right in the middle of our building. Whatever it is. So we don't always have time to stop and gather. But the subject we're speaking about is the best leaders are the best learners. And that has to be true because leaders have to operate with a larger group, larger sum of information. You have to sort through the information that's given to you from all directions. Can you imagine what the president reads on a day-to-day basis? How do you assimilate that type of information? So the higher you climb up the food chain, the more you're going to have to learn. So you need to be a good learner at that level.
I have found that without a doubt, every time I meet a CEO of a company, I find that they are, if they're not voracious readers, they're voracious learners. They're always checking out a case study or watching something on you know, a business show, or they're always talking to other entrepreneurs and asking them how they did it.
Right.
And one might say on the outside, well, you're already the CEO. Why are you trying to learn? Or people would say, well, you know, Dave, you already started this successful school. Mm-hmm. Why are you going back to school? Or why are you learning? Or why are you constantly, is it a hunger inside you that makes you always want to learn more? Or is it just out of necessity? Or what is it that drives you to continue to learn year after year?
Because I'm driving the bus.
Mm. Okay. Okay.
You can sit in row 27 and not worry about where we're going. Mm. I can't afford to do that. I need to know the roads. And so, you know, I have to navigate the changes in the future. There's all types of things. I'm signing contracts and I'm, you know, doing things that I need to have a base of information as the leader. Mm-hmm. And so I have to swallow a bigger chunk of information, and my responsibility is a little bit different from the guy sitting in the 27th row. Almost by necessity, a leader must be voracious in learning his craft, in setting the tone, setting the example. Inevitably, you have very smart people, very talented people following you. You need to have something to offer them.
You won two NBA championships, and you played for an awesome coach. Coach Popovich is one of the best.
Absolutely.
He's a true master of his. He's kind of like a Yoda of coaching. I mean, this guy knows
it. Yoda.
He was your Yoda. Now, he is a guy who, from what I've read, and again, I don't know him first person, but I know what I've read, he sounds like a guy who's always adding something new. Every year, just adding, you know, 1% better here, 2% better here, always kind of never content. And for 20 years that the Spurs as an organization have been successful.
Absolutely.
But this guy, Coach Popovich, he is relentless about being the best coach he can be. How did he demonstrate his commitment to learning and teaching on a daily basis?
He was relentless. We as players saw him constantly breaking down film, working at a relentless pace. And we saw him mature as a person. You know, we saw him, when he first came in, learning how to manage people, learning the craft of being a coach at the NBA level, where, at the college level, you're a little bit more of a teacher.
Okay.
But at the pro level, you're a little bit more of a manager. Mm. So he was learning how to manage personalities and bring those things together so that the team could be reach its peak. And we saw him become a master at that. So we saw him growing and evolving at a tremendous pace. And I think now the whole world sees how he's grown and that he is at the top of his game. So I think he's a great example to look at when you talk about someone who has taken learning to another level in sharpening his leadership craft.
I just love his tenacity about becoming the best coach, because he's already won, what, 4 championships?
Yes.
And this in 2014 might be his best year as a coach, and he's learning how to manage more and more effectively every year. It just seems like he's the best, but he's wanting to get better.
Yeah, well, you know, that's we should never be satisfied. You know, we reach a nice level, but we're not done. We're always growing. We're always stretching. And especially when we're responsible for other people, we should take that very seriously, because those people are growing. Those people are stretching. And we need to recognize that we're guiding them. And I think setting that example is critical.
If I'm a business owner right now and I'm talking to you and I'm saying, I just don't have time. We're struggling so much financially right now. I just don't have the time to learn, let's say, search engine optimization or management or sales or whatever the area is that I'm struggling in. Okay. What would you say to me if I'm somebody who just kind of is refusing to learn or doesn't seem to have a big interest in learning, but I'm the head of a company?
I would say take 6 months, get your company in order. And after that, get on the learning bandwagon. If you can't get your company in order in 6 months, then you probably have problems too big to fix your company. So you may need another leader in there. But you know, you need to take, you know, you need to get yourself to a place where you do have time, because it should be a priority in your life. Maybe you're right. Maybe right now you don't. Maybe your wife is having a baby. Maybe the business requires something. I don't know. But you might be right. Now is not the right time. But this should be a priority for you in the long term. At some point, you need to be extending your learning. And you need to show a passion for learning so that the ones that are working for you can see that.
You read the Bible every, is it every day?
Every day.
Every day?
Every day, yes.
Okay, so you read it every day. And you're a guy who, people who know you say, well, he's high integrity. He is a guy who cares about people. He's a guy who does things the right way. These are the things that you hear about, you know, David Robbins, and we hear about you. But yet you read every day. When you read, what are you hoping to find in there? And why do you keep learning when it seems like you are? I'm just wondering, like, why is it that you keep learning, you know, if you already seem to know these things? What's the deal?
No, that's a great question. I don't know them. That's okay. The problem. My emotions and my flesh take over, and you know, no, I'm searching for truth. You know, we have a tendency to tell ourselves that we're right and we're not right. And we all need a mirror. We all need something to look into to see when there's a smudge on our face, when, you know, we haven't combed our hair. And that's what the Bible is for me. It's a mirror. It's an opportunity to look and say, you know, is my thinking right? Is my heart right? You know, am I being the person I'm supposed to be? Is my perspective right? Am I upset over something that I shouldn't be upset over? You know, so the Bible gives me that type of perspective. And that allows me to stay on an even keel and grow in the other areas. So to me, it's my mirror in the morning.
Do you have a set time that you like to do this every day?
I like to do it early as I can. When I first get up, and I'm an early riser, I was a Navy guy, so, you know, 5 or 6 o'clock is not unusual for me, but I like to spend 10, 15 minutes where I can just meditate, and it might only be one little paragraph, it might be one line.
Yeah.
But you know, you take a proverb, you know, train up a child in the way that he should go, and when he's old, he will not depart from it. It might be one line, but if you spend a few minutes meditating on that, that will give you some peace about your own children. I'm spending all this time with them. I'm so frustrated and they won't do what I say. Well, the thing says, train them up in the way they should go and relax. They will not depart from it. In the end, they'll remember. And so many of days that has calmed my nerves and allowed me to move on to the next things of the day.
I will say this as an action step. If you're watching this and you're struggling to find time to learn, one of my mentors told me years ago, he says, Clay, you're very ambitious. You have 5 kids. So if you're going to grow your company, you're going to have to learn. You're going to have to do it. And so I recommend that you do it before anybody else wakes up. So even though I wasn't a Navy guy and didn't have that, I said I wasn't a morning guy is what I told him. He said, well, you'll probably either be a guy who's doesn't have a very happy wife, or you won't be ambitious very long if you're not learning. So you're going to have to find a way to do it before she wakes up.
Right.
And all of a sudden I realized it doesn't matter how I feel about it. I need to do it.
Right.
And so I began scheduling time and saying, I'm just going to, no matter what, I'm going to get up every morning and just take 15 to 20 minutes and devote myself towards learning whatever I need to know. And I think it's fabulous how much improvement you can make in a year. Yeah. If you think about it, if you just take 15 minutes a day for a year, man, you can learn some powerful stuff.
Adds up to a lot of time. So I think that's a great action step for most people. And it could be the morning. It could be the evening. It could be lunchtime.
Yeah.
It could be a time when, hey, I want to eat a little bit less anyway.
Yeah.
So I don't want to take 15 minutes of my lunch and just sit down and read something. So, yeah, I mean, that's a great action step for people to say, okay, I don't have a lot of time, but I will find it.
Final question for you, David. You have this unbelievable passion for teaching people and for helping people learn. And I've noticed that when I encountered new information, I discovered the possibilities that I could actually be successful. When I studied successful people, I realized that if I study these people and do what they do, I have a good chance of also being successful. How can you speak just a little bit about the magic that can happen when you learn new things and discover possibilities, and just why you are so passionate about putting the learning experiences in front of kids?
I mean, it's exciting. I see a light go off in their head, and they all of a sudden they take my idea and they turn it into something that I would have never thought about. So, you know, to me, when you put a different mind to an idea, who knows what comes out of that? That's very exciting. And when I see these children, we work with a lot of kids at Carver. I see possibilities. I see the next guy that's going to get us to space, or the next guy that's going to invent my next cell phone. So the possibilities are endless. It's to me, it's wonderful and it's exciting. And it's no different for us, even as we get older. Maybe we don't learn a language quite as quickly, but the things that we are passionate about, the things that we are good about, we can learn extremely quickly, and we can assimilate into our lives in a wonderful manner. So we should keep pressing ourselves, and we should keep focusing on our strengths, and we should grow in those areas.
David, I appreciate you for setting a great example of what it means to be a leader on the court, off the court, to be a guy who's passionate about learning, and now a guy who's passionate about teaching. I know you're a teacher at heart. And I just want to tell you, thank you so much for giving us the opportunity to learn a little bit from you.
Well, thanks,
Clay. And it just means the world to me. So thank you so much, sir.
That's a blessing. Thank you, Clay.
Appreciate it.
JT, do you know what time it is?
4:10.
It's Tebow time in Tulsa, Jerusalem, baby. Tim Tebow is coming to Tulsa, Oklahoma, June 27th and 28th. We've been doing business conferences here since 2005. I've been hosting business conferences since 2005. What year were you born?
1995.
Dude, I've been hosting business conferences since you were 10 years old, but I've never had the two-time Heisman Award-winning Tim Tebow come present. And a lot of people, you know, have followed Tim Tebow's football career on the field and off the field. And off the field, the guy's been just as successful as he has been on the field. Now, the big question is, JT, how does he do it?
Well, they're going to have to come and find out, because I don't know.
Well, I'm just saying, Tim Tebow's going to teach us how he organizes his day, how he organizes his life, how he's proactive with his faith, his family, his finances. He's going to walk us through his mindset that he brings into the gym, into business. It is going to be a blasty blast in Tulsa, Jerusalem. Also, this is the first Thrive Time Show event that we've had where we're going to have a man who has built a $100 million net worth.
Wow.
Who'll be presenting. Now, we've had a couple presenters that have had a $1 billion net worth in some like real estate sort of things.
Yeah.
But this is the first time we've had a guy who's built a service business, and he's built over $100 million net worth in the service business. It's the yacht driving, multi-state living guru of franchising. Peter Taunton will be in the house. This is the founder of Snap Fitness, the guy behind 9-Round Boxing. He's going to be here in Tulsa, Jerusalem, Oklahoma, June 27th and 28th. JT, why should everybody want to hear what Peter Taunton has to say?
Oh, because he's incredible. He's just a fountain of knowledge. He is awesome. He has inspired me listening to him talk. And not only that, he also has, he practices what he teaches. So he's a real teacher. He's not a fake teacher like business school teachers. So you got to come learn from him.
Also, let me tell you this, folks. I don't want to get this wrong, because if I get it wrong, someone's going to say, you screwed that up, buddy. So Michael Levine, this is Michael Levine. He's going to be coming. You say, who's Michael Levine? I don't want to get this wrong. This is the PR consultant of choice for Michael Jackson, for Prince, for Nike, for Charlton Heston, for Nancy Kerrigan, 34 Grammy Award winners, 43 New York Times bestselling authors he's represented, including pretty much everybody you know who's been a super celebrity. This is Michael Levine, a good friend of mine. He's going to come and talk to you about personal branding and the mindset needed to be super successful. The lineup will continue to grow. We have hit Christian recording artist Colton Dixon in the house. Now, people say, Colton Dixon's in the house? Yes, Colton Dixon's in the house. So if you like top 40 Christian music, Colton Dixon's going to be in the house performing. The lineup will continue to grow each and every day. We're going to add more and more speakers to this all-star lineup. But I encourage everybody out there today, get those tickets today. Go to ThriveTimeShow.com. Again, that's ThriveTimeShow.com. And some people might be saying, well, how do I do it? What do I do? How does it work? You just go to ThriveTimeShow.com. Let's go there now. We're feeling the flow. We're going to ThriveTimeShow.com. Again, you just go to ThriveTimeShow.com. You click on the business conferences button, and you click on the request tickets button right there. The way I do our conferences is we tell people it's $250 to get a ticket.
Yep.
Or whatever price that you could afford. And the reason why I do that is I grew up without money. JT, you're in the process of building a super successful company.
Yep.
You start out with $1 million in the bank account?
No, I did not. Nope, did not get any loans, nothing like that. Did not get an inheritance from parents or anything like that. I had to work for it, and I'm super grateful I came to a business conference. That's actually how I met you, met Peter Taunton. I met all these people.
So if you're out there today and you want to come to our workshop, again, you just got to go to thrivetimeshow.com. You might say, well, when's it going to be? June 27th and 28th. You might say, well, who's speaking? We already covered that. You might say, where's it going to be? It's going to be in Tulsa, Rusalem, Oklahoma. And someone says, Tulsa, Rusalem. I'm really trying to rebrand Tulsa as Tulsa, Rusalem, sort of like the Jerusalem of America. But if you type in Thrive Time Show and Jinx, you can get a sneak peek or a look at our office facility. This is what it looks like. This is where you're headed. It's going to be a blasty blast. You can look inside, see the facility. We're going to have hundreds of entrepreneurs here. It is going to be packed. Now, for this particular event, folks, the seating is always limited because my facility isn't a limitless convention center. You're coming to my actual home office, and so it's going to be packed. So when June 27th and 28th, you're going to come. I'm talking to you. You can just get your tickets right now at thrivetimeshow.com. And again, you can name your price. We tell people it's $250 or whatever price you can afford. And we do have some select VIP tickets, which gives you an access to meet some of the speakers and those sorts of things. And those tickets are $500. It's a two-day interactive business workshop, over 20 hours of business training. We're going to give you a copy of my newest book, The Millionaire's Guide to Becoming Sustainably Rich. You're going to leave with a workbook. You're going to leave with everything you need to know to start and grow a super successful company. It's practical, it's actionable, and it's Tebow time right here in Tulsa, Jerusalem. Get those tickets today at thrivetimeshow.com. Again, that's thrivetimeshow.com.
Hello, I'm Michael Levine, and I'm talking to you right now from the center of Hollywood, California, where I have represented, over the last 35 years, 58 Academy Award winners, 34 Grammy Award winners, 43 New York Times bestsellers. I've represented a lot of major stars, and I've worked with a lot of major companies. And I think I've learned a few things about what makes them work and what makes them not work. Now, why would a man living in Hollywood, California, in the beautiful sunny weather of LA, come to Tulsa? Because last year I did it and it was damn exciting. Clay Clark has put together an exceptional presentation, really life-changing. And I'm looking forward to seeing you then. I'm Michael Levine. I'll see you in Tulsa.
James, did I tell you my good friend John Lee Dumas is also joining us at the in-person, two-day interactive Thrive Time Show business workshop? That Tim Tebow and that Michael Levine will be at. Have I told you this?
You have not told me that.
Oh, he's coming all the way from Puerto Rico. This is John Lee Dumas, the host of the chart-topping EOFire.com podcast. He's absolutely a living legend. This guy started a podcast after wrapping up his service in the United States military. And he started recording this podcast daily in his home to the point where he started interviewing big time folks like Gary Vaynerchuk, like Tony Robbins. And he just kept interviewing bigger and bigger names, putting out shows day after day. And now he is the legendary host of the EO Fire podcast. And he's traveling all the way from Puerto Rico to Tulsa, Oklahoma to attend the in-person June 27th and 28th Thrive Time Show, two-day interactive business workshop. If you're out there today, folks, you've ever wanted to grow a podcast, a broadcast, you want to improve your marketing, if you've ever wanted to improve your marketing, your branding, if you've ever wanted to increase your sales, you want to come to the two-day interactive June 27th and 28th Thrive Time Show business workshop featuring Tim Tebow, Michael Levine, John Lee Dumas, and countless big-time, super successful entrepreneurs. It's going to be life-changing. Get your tickets right now at thrivetimeshow.com. James, what website is that?
thrivetimeshow.com.
James, one more time with more enthusiasm.
thrivetimeshow.com.
Sunshine, everything rides on tonight. Even if I got 3 strikes, I'ma go for it. This moment, we own it. I'm not to be played with, because it could get dangerous. See these people I ride with. This moment, we own it.
Thrive Time Show, two-day interactive business workshops are the world's highest rated and most reviewed business workshops because we teach you what you need to know to grow.
You can learn the proven 13-point business systems that Dr. Zellner and I have used over and over to start and grow successful companies. I mean, we get into the specific steps on what you need to do to optimize your website. We're going to teach you how to fix your conversion rate. We're going to teach you how to do a social media marketing campaign that works. How do you raise capital? How do you get a small business loan? We teach you everything you need to know here during a 2-day, 15-hour workshop. It's all here for you. You work every day in your business, but for 2 days you can escape and work on your business and build these proven systems so now you can have a successful company that will produce both the time freedom and the financial freedom that you deserve. You're going to leave energized, motivated, but you're also going to leave empowered. The reason why I've built these workshops is because as an entrepreneur, I always wish that I had this. And because there wasn't anything like this, I would go to these motivational seminars, no money down, real estate, Ponzi scheme, get motivated seminars, and they would never teach me anything. It was like you went there and you paid for the big chocolate Easter bunny, but inside of it, it was a hollow nothingness. And I wanted the knowledge, and they're like, oh, but we'll teach you the knowledge after our next workshop. And the great thing is we have nothing to upsell. At every workshop, we teach you what you need to know. There's no one in the back of the room trying to sell you some next big get-rich-quick, walk-on-hot-coals product. It's literally, we teach you the brass tacks, the specific stuff that you need to know to learn how to start and grow a business. And I encourage you to not believe what I'm saying, and I want you to Google the Z66 Auto Auction. I want you to Google Elephant in the Room. Look at Robert Zellner and Associates. Look them up and say, are they successful because they're geniuses, or are they successful because they have a proven system? When you do that research, you will discover that the same systems that we use in our own business can be used in your business. Come to Tulsa, book a ticket, and I guarantee you it's going to be the best business workshop ever, and we'll even give you your money back if you don't love it. We've built this facility for you, and we're excited to see you.
Now you may be thinking, what does it actually cost to attend an in-person 2-day interactive Thrive Time Show business workshop? Well, good news. The tickets are $250 or whatever price that you can afford. What? Yes, they're $250 or whatever price you can afford. I grew up without money and I know what it's like to live without money. So if you're out there today and you want to attend our in-person 2-day interactive business workshop, all you got to do is go to thrivetimeshow.com to request those tickets. And if you can't afford $250, we have scholarship pricing available to make it affordable for you.
I learned at the Academy, Kings Point in New York, acta non verba. Watch what a person does, not what they say.
Good morning, good morning, good morning. Robert Kiyosaki, the Rich Dad Radio Show. Today I'm broadcasting from Phoenix, Arizona, not Scottsdale, Arizona. They're closed, but they're completely different worlds. And we have a special guest today. Definition of intelligence is, if you agree with me, you're intelligent. And so this gentleman is very intelligent. I've done his show before also, but very seldom do you find somebody who lines up on all counts. And it's a Mr. Clay Clark. He's a friend of a good friend, Eric Trump. But we're also talking about money, bricks, and how screwed up the world can get in a few and a half hour. So Clay Clark is a very intelligent man. And there's so many ways we could take this thing. But I thought, since you and Eric are close, Trump, what were you saying about what Trump can't, what Donald, who's my age, and I can say or cannot say?
I have to honor you, sir. I want to show you what I did to one of your books here. There's guy by the name of Jeremy Thorne, who was my boss at the time. I was 19 years old, working at Faith Highway. I had a job at Applebee's, Target, and DirecTV. And he said, have you read this book, Rich Dad, Poor Dad? And I said, no. And my father, may he rest in peace, he didn't know these financial principles. So I started reading all of your books and really devouring your books. And I went from being an employee to self-employed to the business owner to the investor. And I owe a lot of that to you. And I just wanted to take a moment to tell you thank you so much for allowing me to achieve success. And then I'll tell you all about Eric Trump. But I just want to tell you thank you, sir, for changing my life.
But not only that, Clay, you know, thank you, but you've become an influencer. You know, more than anything else, you've evolved into an influencer where your word has more and more power. So that's why I congratulate you on becoming. Because as you know, there's a lot of fake influencers out there too, or bad influencers.
Yeah.
So anyway, I'm glad you and I agree so much. And thanks for reading my books.
Yeah.
That's the greatest thrill for me today. Not a thrill, but recognition is when people, young men especially, come up and say, I read your book, changed my life, I'm doing this, I'm doing this, I'm doing this.
I learned at the Academy, Kings Point in New York, acta non verba. Watch what a person does, not what they say.
Whoa. Hey, I'm Ryan Wimpy. I'm originally from Tulsa, born and raised here. I went to a small private liberal arts college and got a degree in business, and I didn't learn anything like they're teaching here. I didn't learn linear workflows. I learned stuff that I'm not using, and I haven't been using for the last 9 years. So what they're teaching here is actually way better than what I got at business school. And I went what was actually ranked as a very good business school. The linear workflow for us in getting everything out on paper and documented is really important. Like we have workflows that are kind of all over the place. So the having linear workflow and seeing that mapped out on multiple different boards is pretty awesome. That's really helpful for me. The atmosphere here is awesome. I definitely just stared at the walls figuring out how to make my facility look like this place. This place rocks. It's invigorating. The walls are super, it's just very cool. The atmosphere is cool. The people are nice. It's a pretty cool place to be. Very good learning atmosphere. I literally want to model it and steal everything that's here at this facility and basically create it just on our business side.
Once I saw what they were doing, I knew I had to get here at the conference. This is probably the best conference or seminar I've ever been to in over 30 years in business.
You're not bored. You're awake, alive the whole time. It's not pushy. They don't try to sell you a bunch of things.
I was looking to learn how to just get control of my life, my schedule, and just get control of the business.
Planning your time, breaking it all down, making time for the F6 in your life, and just really implementing it and sticking with the program.
It's really lively. They're pretty friendly, helpful, and very welcoming.
I attended a conference a couple months back, and it was really the best business conference I've ever attended.
At the workshop, I learned a lot about time management, really prioritizing what's the most important.
Biggest takeaways are, you want to take a step-by-step approach to your business. Whether it's marketing, what are those three marketing tools that you want to use, to human resources.
Some of the most successful people and successful businesses in this town, their owners were here today because they wanted to know more from Clay, and I found that to be kind of fascinating.
The most valuable thing that I've learned is diligence, that businesses don't change overnight. It takes time and effort, and you gotta go through the ups and downs of getting it to where you wanna go.
He actually gives you the roadmap out. I was stuck, didn't know what to do, and he gave me the roadmap out step by step.
We've set up systems in the business that make my life much easier, allow me some time freedom.
Here you can ask any question you want, they guarantee it'll be answered.
This conference like motivates me and also give me a lot of knowledge and tools.
It's up to you to do this. Everybody can do these things. There's stuff that everybody knows, but if you don't do it, nobody else can do it for you.
I can see the marketing working, and it's just an approach that makes sense.
Probably the most notable thing is just the income increase that we've had.
Everyone's super fun. It's super motivating. I've been here before, but I'm back again because it motivates me.
Your competition's going to come eventually or try to pick up these tactics. So if you don't, somebody else will.
I'm Rachel with Tip Top Canine, and we just want to give a huge thank you to Clay and Vanessa Clark.
Hey guys, I'm Ryan with Tip Top Canine. Just want to say a big thank you to Thrive 15. Thank you to Make Your Life Epic. We love you guys, we appreciate you, and really just appreciate how far you've taken us.
This is our old house, right? This is where we used to live 2 years ago. This is our old neighborhood.
So this is my old van and our old school marketing, and this is our old team. And by team, I mean it's me and another guy.
This is our new house with our new neighborhood.
This is our new van with our new marketing, and this is our new team. We went from 4 to 14, and I took this beautiful photo. We worked with several different business coaches in the past, and they were all about helping Ryan sell better and just teaching sales, which is awesome, but Ryan is a really great salesman. So we didn't need that. We needed somebody to help us get everything that was in his head out into systems, into manuals and scripts, and actually build a team. So now that we have systems in place, we've gone from 1 to 10 locations in only a year.
In October 2016, we grossed 13 grand for the whole month. Right now it's 2018, the month of October. It's only the 22nd. We've already grossed a little over 50 grand for the whole month, and we still have time to go. We're just thankful for you, thankful for Thrive and your mentorship, and we're really thankful that you guys have helped us to grow a business that we run now instead of the business running us. Just thank you, thank you, thank you, times a thousand.
So we really just want to thank you, Clay, and thank you, Vanessa, for everything you've done, everything you've helped us with. We love you guys.
If you decide to not attend the Thrive Time Workshop, you're missing out on a great opportunity.
The atmosphere of Clay's office is very lively. You can feel the energy as soon as you walk through the door, and it really got me and my team very excited.
If you decide not to come, you're missing out on an opportunity to grow your business, bottom line.
Love the environment. I love the way that Clay presents and teaches. It's a way that not only allows me to comprehend what's going on, but he explains it in a way to where it just makes sense.
The SEO optimization, branding, marketing, I've learned more in the last 2 days than I have the entire 4 years of college.
The most valuable thing that I've learned, marketing is key. Marketing is everything.
Making sure that you're branded accurately and clearly.
How to grow a business using Google reviews, and then just how to optimize our name through our website also.
Helpful with a lot of marketing, search engine optimization, helping us really rank high in Google.
The biggest thing I needed to learn was how to build my foundation, how to systemize everything and optimize everything, build my SEO.
How to become more organized. More efficient.
How to make sure the business is really there to serve me as opposed to me constantly being there for the business.
New ways of advertising my business as well as recruiting new employees.
Group interviews, number one. Before we felt like we were held hostage by our employees. Group interviews has completely eliminated that because you're able to really find the people that would really be the best fit.
Hands-on, how to hire people, how to deal with human resources, a lot about marketing and overall just how to structure the business, how it works for me, and also then how that can translate into working better for my clients.
The most valuable thing I've learned here is time management.
I like the 1 hour of doing your business is real critical if I'm gonna grow and change.
Clay really teaches you how to navigate through those things and not only find freedom, but find your purpose in your business and find the purposes for all those other people that directly affect your business as well.
Everybody.
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 Everyone needs to attend the conference because you get an opportunity to see that it's real.